Hello aspirants, looking at current affairs for 10th March. 9th March news would also be covered, don't worry. The news items that we have picked up from today's newspaper are these 14. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, villagers in Tripura lynch Bangladesh security guard. So this is regarding an incident which took place in the South Tripura village. So here the villagers, they say that Bangladesh security personnel, means these were Ansar organization, 10 people from this Ansar organization, which is an auxiliary force of the Bangladesh police. So these 10 and 2 civilians forcefully entered into their homes. There are these 12 families of this village, which are actually on the other side of the border now because of the bilateral agreement with Bangladesh. So what is this bilateral agreement? We'll discuss that too. So this is an enclave here. What is this enclave and this bilateral agreement? We'll discuss. So here, since they entered into their homes, they say they tried to loot them. So that is why these villagers fought with them with bamboo sticks, kitchen knives. One Ansar man was killed and another civilian has been caught while others fled. So what is this enclave and this land boundary agreement, as it is known as, between India and Bangladesh? We'll see. So this is an enclave, means a landmass of a particular country which is surrounded completely by a territory of another country. So here is an example given. So these are actually orders of enclaves: first order enclave, second order enclave, third order enclave. So means this you can see represents India and this Bangladesh. So this is an actual example. So this is a region belonging to India, this belongs to Bangladesh, this belongs to India, and again this region belongs to Bangladesh. So of course the question is that how come such enclaves did exist in the first place? So this exchange of enclaves was the agreement which took place so that this administration becomes feasible, because administration as such cannot happen because India could not administer here, because this four region is completely Bangladesh. We are here. How would India ensure that administration takes place in this region? It is difficult. So these civilians here, people residing here, were actually neither Indians nor Bangladeshis in terms of governance reaching to them. So that is why this exchange agreement, land boundary agreement, was finalized and put into effect so that the resolving of this one critical issue can take place. These civilians are also benefited. Now, of course, the question is that how did these enclaves exist in the first place? So there's an interesting story behind this, because these regions were earlier ruled by kings. So the kings here, they would play games with one another and they would put land on stake. So even board games, etc., played land put on stake. So what they did was, if this land is put on stake, say for example, so if the king loses, then this land goes away to the other king. And then when the other king later is another playing or in a game again later, when he wants to put on stake, he puts a smaller part of this land itself on stake and he loses it. So this goes to the former king again. So this resulted in this complicated structure actually existing in the first place. And now presently, it is last year in 2016 that is actually was put into effect and land boundary was changed. Of course, we were trying to resolve this dispute for long. So it was during Indira Gandhi's time that initiatives were taken to rectify this. So a treaty was also finalized, Indira Mujib Treaty of 1974, to resolve this territorial dispute, but then it could not take into effect. And finally, now the next land boundary agreement, which was finalized during former Prime Minister Manmohan Singh's regime in 2011, has finally been put into effect, because it involves land exchange. So means land being given or taken, so that requires more consensus required. The parliament should approve it. So those aspects have to be taken care of. So you can see here the regions involved. So Bangladesh, India share this boundary here. You can see the states involved are West Bengal. So five states have boundary with Bangladesh, Indian states: West Bengal, Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura, and there is also Mizoram here, but then Mizoram did not have any exchange of enclaves as such. So four states were affected. So India has 111, had I should say, 111 enclaves, and Bangladesh 51 enclaves, and these exchange of land and population had to take place. So this is there. Then the next news item is Punjab varsity develops new BT cotton variety. So this is Punjab Agriculture University. We have discussed this earlier too. It was announced that country's first genetically modified variety of cotton has been developed. Means indigenously developed by Punjab Agricultural University in Ludhiana. So these seeds can be reused by farmers with no commercial restrictions. So presently Monsanto, which is a US company, which is providing these BT cotton seeds, it has a patent in India too. So it the seeds which are provided, they can be used only once. So these are breeder seeds. So breeder seeds can be used once, later they cannot be reused again. You have to buy seeds every time. So that is how they are manufactured. So this genetically modified cotton seeds, which have been developed by Punjab Agriculture University here, they will have no commercial restrictions. You can reuse them. So this will result in savings. There will be no repeated purchases as such required. So that is this present development. So Indian Council of Agricultural Research, ICAR, has identified there are three BT cotton varieties actually. Two are by Punjab Agriculture University and one is also by Rajasthan Agricultural University of Bikaner. So these have been named here. PAU-BT1, F1861 and RS-2013. Of course, you don't need to remember these names specifically. So these would be cultivated in these states, Punjab, Haryana and Rajasthan. So the modification, genetic modification, which takes place is by insertion of this gene, CRY1AC gene. So this is what Monsanto also did, that this gene which imparts resistance against bollworm. So bollworm is the pest which affects cotton crops and this results in loss of cotton because of this infestation. So this gene actually is put into the cotton seeds. When this gene is brought in or introduced with the help of, this is a bacterial gene, means from the bacteria. So that's why it's called BT. So this is a bacterial gene which is put into the cotton seed, and because of this, this gene actually is a code for protein which can kill the bollworm cotton pest. So this is the genetic modification done, gene insertion done, so that bollworm will not affect the cotton crop and then cotton cultivation is better. So the harvest is better. So cotton is the only genetic modified crop which is allowed in the country to be cultivated presently. There's no other GM crop which has been given approval by India. So that is there. And BT cotton, it is sown in huge quantity. So there is a huge industry actually here for BT cotton. There has recently been an issue with Monsanto. So Monsanto owns a patent for BT cotton. So this Monsanto US company has developed this BT cotton with the help of CRY1AC gene, which has been taken from the bacteria Bacillus thuringiensis. So this is inserted into the cotton seed. We just saw that it makes the cotton seed then immune to bollworms. But then the issue is that bollworms are the major pest which infest cotton, but then presently we are seeing that many have also developed immunity. So then this BT cotton is not effective again. So such incidents have also been reported from states. So Punjab specifically, there have been such incidents reported. So that is also a question. Plus another case is that this bollworm is not the only pest infesting. So there have been other cases also of whitefly and other pests also infesting cotton and cotton crop being destroyed. So that is also a concern. And also the BT cotton patent which has been taken by the, which has been granted to Monsanto by India. So that is for bollgard too. For bollgard one, actually patent was not initiated, process was not initiated only by Monsanto. It was only for bollgard two that patent has been provided in 2009. So once patent has been provided, what happens is it has the monopoly. So Monsanto has the monopoly to sell this BT cotton. What it does, it has provided licensing agreements to various Indian seed companies. So Indian seed companies are given the license that we allow you to manufacture this BT cotton seeds and they can manufacture. So they have to pay this license fee. So the license fee which is demanded by Monsanto, actually it has been claimed now that they are overcharging because it's a monopoly. Whatever the demand has to be paid. So based on this accusation, actually government has initiated prosecution on them under the Competition Commission of India too, and government passed this Seeds Price Control Order of 2015, which has resulted in a litigation in the judiciary too. So that is the whole mess which presently is this issue is in. This is an earlier incident of actually BT cotton variety being indigenously developed. So this claim was made, but actually it was realized, this was in 2009, but it was realized that they are using the same gene which actually has been patented by Monsanto. So that was a controversy which had come up here. So this was withdrawn later by ICAR and now presently is the news of Punjab Agriculture University developing. So this is there. Then this is regarding Monsanto. So it is based in USA. It has formed a joint venture here. You can see Maharashtra Hybrid Seeds Company, Myco, and Monsanto have come together. So this, where Monsanto has 26% holding, has been formed. So it's a joint venture here, and they are here sub-licensing BT cotton technology to various seed companies in India. So this is there. Then this is the present recent incident which has taken place and the controversy involved. So this is in November 2015. The Union Agriculture Ministry asked the Competition Commission of India to look into allegations about the monopolistic practice of this Monsanto Myco Biotechnology Limited. Then later Center issued a notification, this was in December 2015, that BT cotton seeds would come under price control order. So they would put restrictions on how much maximum price can be there. So that was there. So center also set up a committee, 9-member committee was set up to decide on MSP for GM cotton seeds. So that was also there. And then in 2016, we see that National Seeds Association of India actually opposed this price control order. So that was there because Indian seed manufacturing companies were the ones which were given the sub-license. So they were also profiting. So they opposed the price control order. Then MMBL moved the Delhi High Court, seeking a stay on the center's price control order. But the Delhi High Court refused to stay. So that was the status, and it is looking into the matter. So a detailed probe against Monsanto will be undertaken by CCI, Competition Commission of India, that it is violating competition law for BT cotton technology in India. This you can see the maximum prices, price control order which came. So maximum prices for Boll Guard 1 and Boll Guard 2 cotton were announced. So you can see what fee can be maximum taken. So that was also brought down to 73%. So that was to benefit the farmers here. This again, it says implementation is subject to Delhi High Court ruling. Delhi High Court ruling refused to stay this order. So this order continues. Then the next news item is paid maternity leave extended to 26 weeks. So the Lok Sabha has presently passed this Maternity Benefit Amendment Bill 2016. So under this bill now, which already Rajya Sabha has passed, working women in organized sector will be entitled to paid maternity leave of 26 weeks. So from 12 weeks, means around 4 months, it has been extended to 26 weeks now. So that is the benefit they'll get. And this will apply to all establishments. So organized sector means any establishment employing 10 or more people. So this will be applicable to these organizations, and it will be applicable only for the first two children. For the third child born, maternity leave would be 12 weeks only. So that is there. And also this makes India at the third position amongst the major countries in the world where maternity leave is of such a high time frame. So in Canada, there is 50 weeks maternity leave, paid maternity leave. Norway has 44 weeks, and now India has 26 weeks. The next news item is India-Pakistan DGMOs hold talks. So this is regarding Director General of Military Operations on India and Pakistan side. There was an unscheduled call between the two, and Indian side has conveyed its concerns to Pakistan regarding movement of terrorists along the LOC. So this infiltration takes place across the LOC. During winter, rather, infiltration is low because of the geographical and climatic conditions at that time. But later, as summer sets in, infiltration is bound to increase. And with the present time, when the unrest in Jammu and Kashmir is high, we are seeing that people are pelting stones on officials here and trying to protect the terrorists. So that again makes it important for armed forces to be ready to tackle this situation. And that has been put to the attention of Pakistan as well. The two people of Pakistani nationalism, they had been caught by the forces here after the Uri terror attack. So they have also been handed over now. And I handed over these Pakistani youths back to Pakistan. So this has been the present development which has taken place. Then the next news item is no change in India's stance on UNSC vote. So this was in news on 9th March, it's there in news, that UN Security Council reforms which are proposed and the organization, this is a grouping, not an organization, to four nations grouping. So this is called G4. So this G4 are four nations which have come together to pitch in together for their permanent membership in UN Security Council. So you should know by now that there are five permanent members in UN Security Council, and there are other countries too, including India. India is one of the members of G4 who want to be members of UN Security Council. So these are India, Japan, Brazil, and Germany. So these four nations have come together, and presently there was this intergovernmental negotiation by UN General Assembly. So here India's ambassador to UN had spoken and had said that we are open to fresh ideas, new ideas. So the proposal which was there is that it should not be rigid, that we want permanent membership with veto power, because that is the thing, that one, you get permanent membership to UN Security Council as P5 countries have, but it's not just that, means there are 15 nations in UN Security Council. So that is like the executive decision making body. General Assembly is like the legislature, UN General Assembly, and UN Security Council is the actual decision making body. So 15 members here, 5 are permanent, means they'll always be members, and from the remaining 10, they have a 2-year term. Nations are elected for 2-year term as such. So one thing is permanent membership, that you will be permanently member of UN Security Council, and another thing which is there is that these 5 permanent members individually have veto power. So we have discussed this quite often, I suppose you should be knowing about this by now, that any resolution which comes for voting, if any one of the P5 members, say China, as we are seeing in case of Masood Azhar too, so if any one country also says no, we do not agree with this, and remaining 14 say yes, it will not be done. Veto is the right to reject, actually. So individually each country has a right to reject, each 5 of these countries. So what is demanded is actually that this P5 countries are not the only ones representing the present global scenario. So that is why there are other prominent countries which have emerged, like India. China is a member. US, China, UK, France, and Russia. So these are the 5 permanent members. So India, Japan, Germany, Brazil are also prominent countries. Also G4 has pitched in for at least one African country also to be there as a permanent member of UNSC. So this is what we are trying to do, bringing in reforms in the United Nations. And now to show in flexibility here, what the Indian ambassador presently said at this intergovernmental negotiations was that it's not that we want permanent membership and the veto rights together. So it's okay that once we get the permanent membership, at least is assured, and then we work towards veto power. So at least for 15-year time frame, it can be looked into, and later this power is given is acceptable, because this has been in news. G4 has been formed a decade ago now, more than a decade, I should say. So there is no movement taking place on UN reform. So bringing in some flexibility so that steps can be taken is what the government is trying to do. So that was clarified presently too. So this is what it is all about. So these are the G4 countries and how they have been voting in UN Security Council too. That has been shown that they do not abstain. So you can either vote for, vote against, or abstain. So abstain means not voting at all. So that has been low for these 4 countries. So they have been assertively voting as such in UN Security Council resolutions. Then the next news item is committee ticks off government on defense allocations. So presently you should know budget has been proposed and put forth before the parliament. So parliament standing committees look into various provisions of the budget, and parliamentary standing committee on defense is looking into the defense aspect of the budget. And presently it has pointed out that the allocations which have been made in the present budget 2017-18 for defense are inadequate. We have already discussed budget, and it was clear that not much allocation was done to defense. And the finance minister, the reasoning which he gave for this was, at that time, Mr. Arun Jaitley, that since there's a delay in payments as such, so there's no need for much allocation done presently. When there's a requirement, we'll look into it. So that was the stand given. But this parliamentary standing committee has presently pointed out that the defense budget which has been provided is not sufficient to meet even the committed liabilities presently in the case of Navy. So what has been committed, these payments would be done for procurements. So that would not be possible. So that is the status, and new arrangements being done, new agreements coming forth is another matter. For committed ones also, there is not enough allocation. Also, same thing for Army and Air Force has also been pointed out, that allocation for Army is also not sufficient, as well as for the Air Force as such too. So that's what is being pointed out. Even it says the Make in India initiative, which the government had started, even under this, the expenditure spending which has been done is about 1% of the total. So how much of Make in India is taking place is also very less. So there is so much of amount which has to be paid for imports as such. It's not Make in India. So that is a huge amount of expenditure which is being done, and that is why the parliamentary committee is saying that the allocation done is not sufficient. You can see this was the reasoning given, that lower allocations are done because there's slow pace of spending. But then the parliamentary committee has pointed out that Ministry of Defense has not approved, many pending approvals are there. Ministry of Finance actually has not approved these pending proposals, crucial proposals which are there, they are pending. So approvals are also not coming forth is highlighted. Then the next news item is no changes in H-1B visa program. So this is the US administration saying that H-1B visa program for skilled temporary foreign workers, for this year there will be no changes. So changes, modifications which have come forth, increasing the minimum salary as such, that would be not applicable this year. So it starts off in the month of April, on 1st of April, the process of selection of H-1B visas take place. US admits 85,000 people every year for H-1B visas. So this is done through a lottery process. So that means a lottery. There is no scrutiny done of forms and then selection done, but it's a lottery process. So applications, will, this process will start from 1st April, and there are no changes for this year. It has been clarified. And also it said that US President Donald Trump presently, he prefers merit-based immigration as opposed to family-linked immigration. Means people should migrate to US for on the basis of merit, that they are bringing some skill, rather than for family linkages, that you are going to stay and be a burden on the economy as such, or contribute to the economy. So that is the way it's looked into, merit-based and family-linked. So that is there. So this is good for India, because many Indian tech workers, they go for on merit basis only. But then another thing is there, what he opposes is that immigrant workers, they are replacing American workers. So that is also another aspect. So of course, if Indian immigrants go, they contribute to the economy in USA too. But then another contradicting issue is that American workers, it is said, they lose their jobs. But then since they are not there, requirement is not fulfilled, that is why Indians go up. And another, of course, allegation is that Indians are ready to work at a lower salary. So those aspects are also there. So that is there. And the work permit issue is also there. So work permit, which is provided to spouses of H-1B visa holders. So this was initiated through an executive order of Obama, Barack Obama administration. So this also is on priority, that changes would be made to this also. That work permit for spouses of H-1B visa holders should, their modification should take place. Then the next news item is Commonwealth trade meet begins. So on 8th of March, we have already discussed what is Commonwealth, this multilateral organization. So they are having this trade meet. So Commonwealth is of course spearheaded by UK, and Brexit, after Brexit has been announced now, UK is looking at trade relations with other countries, and Commonwealth here becomes a major forum too. And there is Commonwealth heads of governments meeting too in 2018 in UK. So it is expected that steps would be taken that intra-group trade amongst the Commonwealth countries increases. So they are targeting at least trade to go to $1 trillion by 2020. By presently it is $750 billion. So this proposal is being made on Commonwealth. The next news item is India sees options in US energy policy. So US administration under President Donald Trump is planning to deregulate America's oil, gas and coal sector. So deregulation means government regulation removed. So here India sees an opportunity, there can be bilateral cooperation between the two countries, because India's energy demand is huge. So 30% of increase in world's energy demand from this time till 2040 will be from India. So that is why, to take care of this demand, of course, we need such bilateral arrangements. And since this deregulation has taken place, it's seen as an opportunity by India. India has also started importing LNG, liquefied natural gas, from USA. So this will start in 2018. Contracts have been signed presently, means under Barack Obama administration. So this import will also take place, and also emphasis is put on right pricing. So if prices are right, then India would also benefit and America would also benefit by sale of this oil, gas and coal sector. also from clean energy technology. So this clean coal technology would also be beneficial for India, converting coal to synthetic gas. So this technique, if transfer technology also take place, then it would benefit India. And another aspect which is also to be looked into is regarding smart grids. So if smart grids are built, because we see that presently there are a lot of transmission and distribution losses, they're called T&D losses. So Indian grid, when electricity is passed on, you know, connected to the grid, connection takes place of these thermal plants, etc., there's a lot of energy which is wasted. So those are called T&D losses, transmission and distribution losses. So the technology which US uses of building these smart grids, which reduces transmission losses, can also be transferred, procured, in the sense we would be paying for all this. So that would also benefit India. So these proposals are being put forth. And also, three Indian public sector companies already have invested in shale gas production in USA. So these are GAIL, Oil India, IOC, and Reliance. So these also, three are in Indian public sector, and Reliance is a private sector. So they have also invested in shale gas. What is shale gas production also, we'll see. So we'll look at all three. What is synthetic gas, clean coal technology, and shale gas. So this synthetic gas, the earliest known such gas was in 1780s, when it was discovered that combustible gas can be generated if water vapor is passed over carbon at very high temperatures, over 500 degrees Celsius. So this gas containing carbon monoxide and hydrogen is formed. It was called water gas then and was used for lighting purposes. So now, using advanced technology, a similar combination, water carbon monoxide mixture of gas was synthesized, and this a similar technique, and this is used to synthesize carbon hydrocarbons as such. So this is called synthetic gas. So this is the present synthetic gas, you can see. So on these hydrocarbons, if steam rolling takes place, so water vapor is passed, synthetic gas is generated. So this is called syngas. So this technology, then clean coal technology. Means clean coal technology means there should be higher efficiency and lower emissions. Means burning of coal should take place at such high temperatures and such great pressures that emissions are reduced. So this technology has also been developed. So emissions are less by about 40%. So that is called clean coal technology. So you can see that supercritical and ultra supercritical coal technologies are presently in operation too. Japan, Australia, USA, these are prominent users of this clean coal technology. So benefits of it is that it is low cost, low operating cost is there, but carbon emissions are more compared to renewable energy sources. Still carbon emissions would be there. There is a reduction, but still emissions are there. Then this is shale gas. You can see this is the shale gas located here, so it's far deeper, and this is the gas, natural gas, which is found. So petroleum, natural gas are found here. Then this is within the sand, the sand gas found here. Along with the coal, there is coal bed methane found. So these are hydrocarbons only, they can be used for generation of electricity. This is non-associated gas, means natural gas without any association with oil. So these are conventional ones, but this shale gas, which is found in this shale, so sandstone, shale, these are rock features. So in these rocks, there is this gas present. So this extraction technology has presently been developed by USA, and it has advanced in this, and shale gas production costs were high earlier. Now they are gradually reducing. So economies of scale as they take place, costs reduce, and they have developed this technology to extract shale gas and fruitfully use it. So in this, we can have cooperation with USA. The next news item is center issues draft rules on e-wallet payments. So e-wallets, they were very much in use post demonetization, Paytm and others, free charge, etc. So these e-wallets means you have a wallet, like how you keep your money in a wallet. This is an online wallet. So these are the prepaid payment instruments. So there are many other sources in which you can have your payment done, and that you can utilize that money from this wallet. So all these prepaid payment instruments now will come under regulation. So this IT security of prepaid instruments rules 2017 has been proposed. So under this, these are draft rules presently. Once finalized, they'll become mandatory. So under this, mandatory means it will become compulsory that all these electronic prepaid payment instruments, they will have to develop an information security policy. So security policy should be there, and because that is the main concern, that if there is any issue, then people will lose their money. So it will be compulsory for them to publish their privacy policy on their websites or mobile with mobile applications, terms for use for their payment systems, and all of them will have to mandatorily carry out risk assessment. to spot security risks, and also due diligence should be taken before issuing any prepaid payment instruments. So this is there under this draft rules now, which would be finalized. Then the next news item is Silk Road made by nomads. So this is the great Silk Road, the old Silk Road, not the Silk Route which we are generally discussing, maritime Silk Road and the new economic Silk Road. So that is the revival of the old Silk Road which China is proposing, developing infrastructure along this region. So original old great Silk Road, this is a study which is saying that this was originally made by nomads. So nomads are these tribal people who travel from place to place. So they are passing through these mountains, pastures, they have their herds along with which they move. So around 5,000 years ago, it is expected that they were developed. These Silk Road routes were developed long before Marco Polo, also the famous traveler who passed through this trade routes and has written about it. So this is a study done. They have used satellite imaging, geographic information system and archaeological analysis to show that the 75% of the ancient Silk Road sites are on the paths which are optimal for movement of herds and these tribals as such, the nomads as such. So that is being shown now. So this is the Silk Road, you can see. So Silk Road, because silk from China here would be exported from this region. So you can see silk. Then ceramics, tea, sugar were also prominent export items from China imported in other regions. Silk textiles here you can see. India was also on this route. Textile taken from here. Chilies here. Then you can see it passes through all the Central Asia and reaches up to here, Constantinople. In Turkey presently, Istanbul, which is what it's presently known as. So it's reaching near till Europe. So that is the, in the Central Asia, you can see horses, lapis lazuli from this region were, camels here were traded in. Then the next news item is ostriches lived in India once. So this is a DNA analysis done of a fossilized eggshell fragment which has been found in India, and they have researchers have said that this shows that ostrich lived in India around 25,000 years ago. So it has 92% genetic similarity with the ostrich species in Africa. So ostriches lived here. It says that maybe this movement took place when Africa and India, the Indian landmass, drifted away from Africa. So at that time means maybe this was at that time that the ostriches were present here. So this is the study done. So you can see here the continental drift theory, as it is known as. So earlier all the continents were as proposed or hypothesized to be together. So you can see India is here. Gradually they drifted away and came to the position where they are presently. So this is India, Australia, Antarctica. So Antarctica, the South Pole. So these, all this region, you can see this dotted line is actually was earlier the South Pole, it is said. Because there are glacial striations here too. So glaciers were present in this region. There is evidence from these striations. Because when glaciers move, they scrape the land. So those striations which are formed are found here. So that evidence shows that continental drift theory is a proof for continental drift theory. So that is why it is, you can see Africa, India were also together and then they drifted apart. The next news item is Neanderthals used aspirin for toothache. So these Stone Age men, during those times when they had these toothache, they used a natural painkiller. So this is found in poplar trees bits. So here they contain salicylic acid. The salicylic acid is the active ingredient which is found presently in aspirin. So they ate this, they chewed these bits of poplar tree leaves. They also ate the antibiotic fungus penicillium. So penicillin, which is there presently, the natural painkillers, they were used by them during those times. So this evidence has been found presently. So you can see aspirin is derived from tree sources. Salicylic acid is the major ingredient. The last news item is potatoes may grow on Mars, shows experiment. So this is an experiment done by International Potato Center in Peru. So this has constructed a special CubeSat. So this CubeSat environment is simulating Martian environment. So how Martian climatic conditions are, the water is available there, the soil conditions, those are simulated, and a trial is being done to grow potatoes here. And this is being looked into And you can see, so this sprouting has presently been seen. The live streaming cameras are recording the soil and the potato sprouting has been seen. So further research would be done, which is the worst case scenario in which potato would also sprout. That is what they are looking into. So the soil and temperature and conditions of Mars are being simulated. So you can see air pressure, oxygen, carbon dioxide levels on Mars, they are maintained here and the results have been positive. So potato growing is possible on Mars. That is what the experiment is showing. So further research of course would take place on this. So these are the news items. Thank you.